A 34-year-old lady presented to the medical unit with fever, headache, and mild disorientation. Bright light made her extremely uncomfortable. This key symptom is called photophobia, or the fear of light. I tried to flex her neck only to feel the stiffness of her neck muscles. This important sign is called neck rigidity. She also had a rash. Can you guess the importance of it? We will get to it later. The classic triad of fever, altered mental status, and neck rigidity made the clinical diagnosis of meningitis highly likely. Now, we were suspecting an infection of the meningeal membranes that cover the brain and spinal cord. Three meningeal layers are pia mater, arachnoid mater, and the dura mater. A fluid called cerebrospinal fluid, or CSF, has all the clues to confirm our diagnosis and to find what organism caused the disease. We can take a sample from the CSF at the lower spine by a procedure called lumbar puncture. Before we go ahead with a lumbar puncture, we have to make sure this spinal tap won't cause brain herniation. Performing a spinal tap in the presence of raised intracranial pressure can force the brainstem and the cerebellar tonsils to herniate into the spinal cavity. We can arrange brain imaging to look for signs of raised intracranial pressure like brain edema, abscess formation, or enlarged ventricles. On the other hand, waiting for imaging can delay the lumbar puncture and administration of targeted antibiotics. Clinically, she didn't have evidence of raised intracranial pressure, so we decided to perform the lumbar puncture without waiting for a brain CT. After taking her consent, I first applied local anesthesia through a small needle. Then I inserted the spinal needle at the lower back in between the third and fourth lumbar vertebrae. This is a safe level since the spinal cord ends at the lower border of the first lumbar vertebra in adults. As the needle pierced into the spinal canal, CSF came out from the other end of the needle. This precious sample was sent to the lab for analysis. As soon as the lumbar puncture samples and blood cultures were sent, we started her on empirical antibiotics, ceftriaxone and vancomycin. Antibiotics kill the bacteria and prevent bacteria-induced neurological damage. But on the other hand, when they are killed, the released toxins can induce another inflammatory response, which can lead to brain edema. To prevent this, we administer the steroid dexamethasone about 20 minutes before the antibiotics. In the CSF report, it was found that there were more than 1,000 white blood cells per microliter of CSF, with a neutrophil predominance. It was not surprising. Neutrophils are our body's trusted fighters against bacteria. This important clue not only confirmed our diagnosis of meningitis, but also indicated that the causative agent is bacterial. The low glucose and high proteins in CSF further supported our diagnosis. Streptococcus pneumoniae is the commonest bacteria that cause meningitis in adults. So I expected to see this on the gram stain of CSF. They appear blue or purple because they are positively stained by the gram dye. They are called diplococci because they occur in pairs of spherical or elliptical bacteria. But here comes the surprise. In the actual gram stain, the shape was still diplococci, but the gram stain was pink or gram negative. This was Neisseria meningitidis. Now it all made sense. The rash we noticed in the initial presentation was characteristic of meningococcal meningitis. The microbiology team was able to grow a culture of the bacteria. It was found to be sensitive to the antibiotic ceftriaxone. We omitted vancomycin and continued ceftriaxone for 7 days. She improved over the next few days without significant complications. Thanks for watching the video. Did you enjoy it? Was it too advanced? Please let me know in the comments section. Subscribe for more interesting medical cases.